Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Our Livable World, Creating the Clean Earth of Tomorrow, by Marc Schaus. Narrated by Matthew Boston. Publisher's note: this audiobook refers to photos included in the print and ebook editions of the book. Preface: COVID-19 and the Environment. Shortly after the manuscript of Our Livable World was completed, tragic news broke from the city of Wuhan in China that a highly contagious, SARS-like virus had migrated from another animal to humans, sending medical teams scrambling and ultimately leading to the outbreak of what we now call COVID-19, also known colloquially, for the moment, as the coronavirus. Through a combination of early-stage government mismanagement and the sheer power of a virus that spreads quickly and easily, the coronavirus soon escaped the city of Wuhan and spread to neighboring cities, provinces, and eventually surrounding countries in all directions. As many of us are now beginning to realize, our world in the 21st century has become far more interconnected than we ever thought possible. We have become more and more globalized with each passing year. The challenges of one nation, particularly if that nation is a major international player, become challenges for the world at large. Such has been the case with COVID-19, an intercontinental menace that quickly moved from regional outbreak to global pandemic. The new coronavirus shot through European nations like a wildfire, igniting explosive epidemics throughout the Middle East, the rest of Asia, and eventually both Americas. As I write these words, the virus has now reached essentially everywhere on Earth. Italy was the first country among us to issue a nationwide lockdown, sheltering every citizen in place to avoid unnecessary contact and spare their hospital wards an overflow of patients. But the emergency declaration was made not nearly soon enough. Intensive care units soon spilled outside of hospital walls into mass-produced tents in nearby parking lots. France would later issue similar orders, requiring anyone venturing outside of their home to carry paperwork clearing them to be out in public. Neighboring Spain deployed their military personnel to ensure that anyone found outside was either on their way to or from an approved location for supplies or treatment. Spanish hotels became annexed hospitals under the never-ending flow of new patients, while public transit buses became bulk transport ambulances to fill them. Iran was especially devastated. Mass graves the Iranian government would later dig to bury their dead were so large they could be seen from space. Lockdown is currently looking very different around the globe. In Italy, residents with a balcony will sometimes serenade each other in the evening to maintain what joie de vivre they can. Apartment tenants have been spotted playing tennis from balcony to balcony, while fitness instructors lead workout classes from adjacent rooftops as students look on from their windows or balconies. The famous canals of Venice, typically crowded with boats and saturated with pollutants, become so clear without daily boat traffic that fish become visible for the first time in years. In America, the coronavirus spread quickly through highly populated states like New York and California, causing lockdowns and shelter-in-place orders that other states would soon emulate to avoid the worst. In Canada, experts believe that we are only now, at the time of this writing, beginning to climb the medical response curve that everyone keeps telling us we need to flatten. It would seem that we're slightly out in front of the virus in terms of saving our ICUs from being overrun, for the moment. But folks are already getting into fistfights over toilet paper at Costco, and what many media outlets are now calling the shut-in economy is very much in full swing. The trouble with writing a book about the good news of technology and our hope against climate change is that optimism can come off as tone-deaf when offered in a period of deep struggle, sickness, and death. And we all know that climate change has already carried a heavy human cost. So I have attempted not to be tone-deaf in this work, even if incredible academic teams and trailblazing tech companies genuinely do have great new options to help with our climate woes. But a global scourge like the new coronavirus ought to remind us that the luxuries we enjoy with 21st century technology can also empower a host of downsides that we need to navigate responsibly. Claiming that there are upsides to a global pandemic can seem equally tone-deaf. The death toll from the coronavirus has already been significant, and it is still rising as I write. I have not yet personally suffered the death of a loved one due to complications from COVID-19, so striking a connection with anyone who has suffered will be difficult. I cannot claim to feel that pain, nor any sense of such a profound loss. But in assessing the impact of this virus from a carbon emissions perspective, and from a view of new tech developments over the years, I'd like to offer some glimmers of hope to consider if you are still listening to this book in a world beset by mandatory social distancing. From a climate standpoint, the slowing and stoppage of industrial activity following lockdown orders has caused carbon emissions to plummet around the world, and even more dramatically, as fewer folks are driving to their jobs or going away on weekends. In fact, there are practically no cars on the road at all in the areas still strictly sheltering in place. Fewer people are using energy-intensive resources in our cities, and several carbon-heavy industries have all but ground to a halt, which in terms of reducing our emissions has been a temporary reprieve for the environment. Satellite imagery has allowed scientists to verify that lockdowns and quarantines have had this pronounced effect on reducing emissions. And again, sickness and recession-induced carbon reductions are nothing that those of us who care about the planet ever hope for. But between the time that China locked down their affected cities and right now, in mid-April 2020, as I write this piece, China's emissions dropped by a full quarter. Coal consumption at power plants was down by 36% without China's massive industries in operation. That is really quite significant. China contributes roughly 30% of our global carbon emissions every year. A drop that stark is akin to more than half the entire annual emissions from the UK alone. Every virus-induced stoppage in industrial activity, electricity production, or transportation has resulted in a net loss of carbon emissions worldwide. Commercial air travel, for example, which contributes roughly 2% of the world's carbon emissions, plunged as travelers stayed home. Compared to previous years, data provider OAG reported that aviation reductions departing from mainland China dropped between 50 and 90% capacity throughout quarantine periods. And when many other nations' borders were closing to prevent incoming infections, those who sought to travel were restricted from doing so. As major events within countries were canceled to prevent the spread of the virus, the number of flights was reduced even further. Analysts expected that major event cancellations like South by Southwest and large sporting events involving flights in from all around the country and from multiple industries saved the world thousands of tons of CO2 emissions from air travel. As New York State swelled with coronavirus cases and social distancing efforts went into fuller effect, an estimated 10% drop in CO2 emissions over the city occurred. Globally, one estimate from the International Energy Agency, IEA, looking at the numbers in early March, suggested that the outbreak would potentially reduce up to 0.5% of worldwide oil demand leading through to September. At the moment, major studies analyzing the emissions impacts of lost industry are hard to come by, but historically, we know that past financial upsets and subsequent emissions reductions have not been very positive in the long run. We typically tend to see a drop in emissions when the markets drop, as in 2008-2009 during the global financial crash, though then see emissions skyrocket during the recovery phase of government stimulus spending. Environmental concerns are often placed on the back burner when folks understandably just want to return to normal life. Indeed, shortly after the 2008-2009 financial crisis, carbon emissions rose by about 5% as a result of boosted fossil fuel use. What may be more important, then, is that a dip in global emissions throughout our self-isolation period can simply buy us some crucial time as we develop the technologies discussed throughout this book, especially the technologies with direct implications for advancing coronavirus treatment and vaccine research, like bioengineering and data sciences. Given the stakes of advancing new COVID-19 treatments and solutions, the global academic community has entered into a new phase of cross-communication. Chinese officials may have bungled their initial response to the virus by withholding crucial information, but the country's scientists would later sequence the COVID-19 genome and release that information online for every lab in the world to use. Since then, an encouraging new trend of doing emergency science has proven that we can generate new knowledge very quickly when we need to. For example, a veritable avalanche of raw data is being released every day by scientists around the world. These daily data sets are made available on preprint servers, open to everyone, prior to academic publication. Labs never used to have access to such open-source knowledge, even just a few years ago during the Ebola scare, when labs were sometimes encouraged to sit on key results until a prestigious publisher would accept them. And looking through these daily data dumps is actually very inspiring. One will find countless authors involved in every new study, with sources spanning universities from nearly as many countries. It is inspiring because, as we now find ourselves facing the same challenges worldwide, there is a rising tide of shared human knowledge beneficial to all. As new research has streamed onto preprint servers, around 10 studies per day, according to one scientist who called the daily deluge a firehouse of information, teams of scientists would then assess these listings on the fly over platforms like Twitter for mutual vetting and to weed out any pseudoscience. Layman's commentary was then directed to mainstream media platforms for expediency and faster public awareness. Only once or twice, by this author's count, did that result in scientists' unintentional spread of misinformation. Far more often, as a result of multiple academic publications taking on more staff to pump out papers at wartime speed, the tide did indeed lift all boats. Open-source viral genomes were posted on academic servers to help labs around the world improve their testing groups. We quickly learned that COVID-19 shares about 80 to 90% of its genetic code with the SARS virus that broke out in 2002-2003, for example. In fact, according to one scientific commentator writing at Science, the level of communication bridged between global scientists has been simply unparalleled. Academic publishers also tend to prioritize releasing information that will generate headlines and prestige, so not the studies generating null results. As a result, labs around the world often engage in plenty of redundancy, working on challenges that other teams have already failed on, but did not publish anything about. Not anymore, thanks to the earlier dissemination of research results. Scientists around the world have been gaining equally crucial insight into what does not work with the virus. With more communication among labs, speedier publication timelines, and increased research and development funding for labs worldwide, new science is advancing faster than ever. This has helped, in part, to create the vaccine timeline that experts seem to be predicting for COVID-19. Vaccines typically take 2 to 5 years of development before public availability, making the estimates of roughly 12 months for a potential coronavirus vaccine impressive, even if that sounds like an eternity while we're self-isolating and learning of those we love falling ill and dying. Even more encouraging, a new line of thinking has emerged in some of the economic elite. Fund precautionary science now to save ourselves the trillions of dollars lost during a global shutdown. Bill Gates, for example, has funded the opening of multiple factories to churn out crucial vaccine data, even though he knew in advance he would lose billions of dollars on the venture. Ultimately, our current challenge in dealing with COVID-19 is a lot of things. Scary, sobering, life-altering, utterly tragic at times. But our experience in dealing with a global pandemic in 2020 can also offer us some crucial lessons for how our species could deal with other large problems. We've seen the worst in early-stage government mismanagement and selfish members of our communities hoarding the resources we all need. But we've also witnessed how lowering our carbon emissions and reducing atmospheric CO2 may well look more manageable after the world's populations suffer through this shared challenge. Many of us are seeing the vast impact that individual actions can carry on a global scale. We are seeing the tangible results of governments with shared goals cooperating to manage mutual problems. We are seeing the adaptability of market forces to solve key problems, with automakers now working on ventilators and distilleries delivering hand sanitizer. We are learning important lessons about the policy levers at our leaders' disposal for empowering at-risk businesses suffering through difficult change. We are also learning the kinds of things we can choose to live without. But perhaps most importantly, we are seeing the immense potential in our academic and medical heroes around the world, and the powerful advancements we can all gain from pooling our intellectual resources together. In short, we are witnessing the impact of collectively carving out a future in which we rise to the moment of our largest challenges and finally behave as though we're in this together, because we truly are. Chapter 1. Scenes from the Climate Crisis. I want you to act as you would in a crisis. I want you to act as if our house is on fire, because it is. Greta Thunberg, Davos. In mid-2019, an ominous headline suggesting that our final few decades were upon us as a species circulated on several popular news media sites. High likelihood of human civilization coming to end by 2050, report finds. The report, produced by an Australian think tank, described in unsettling detail what we might expect in our near future if world governments do nothing about climate change. As you can imagine, the scenario becomes downright apocalyptic by mid-century. It is true that our governments are not doing nearly enough to address climate change. Studies from academic organizations around the world indicate that our current goals, projected greenhouse gas reductions, speed in phasing out fossil fuels, and more, will not be sufficient to avoid the worst repercussions of climate change. Even the attainment of those inadequate goals has not been progressing efficiently. But while being brutally honest about the challenge we face is necessary and appropriate, it is equally important to ensure that doomsday certainty is not the only narrative driving our decisions. As temperatures rise, the report continued, reflective sea ice up north will melt. Widespread loss of our permafrost will occur, and large-scale Amazon drought and dieback will follow. Sea levels will rise rapidly. Cities close to every coast will be inundated with floodwaters. Multiple World Heritage sites will be lost forever. Residents who live in coastal communities will essentially become climate refugees, forced to flee from their homes to neighboring cities and towns, possibly to neighboring countries, if enough of their homeland becomes uninhabitable. Global coalitions will likely fracture and dissipate in the face of resource scarcity and humanitarian crises. Biodiversity will collapse and subsequently implode as mass extinctions occur worldwide. It's important to note that while these premonitions are unlikely to pass in full, they are certainly not impossible. If our governments truly were to do nothing about climate change, or to continue our woefully subpar response from the last decade, some or all of these prophecies could very well be fulfilled. But many of the most dire, apocalyptic scenarios sound more probable than they should, undoubtedly due to the drama-driven news cycle our major media networks tend to use. Amidst all the countless social media shares, viral headlines, and alarming reports, where most of us get our climate change information, plenty of hopeful news gets lost in the shuffle. Thoughts about climate change then seem to shift from a narrative of possibilities and innovations to the never-ending cycle of chaos, leading us inexorably to the end of our civilization in just a few decades. Many of us in North America may picture the California wildfires and the rolling electrical blackouts. Some of those blackouts, we'll remember, were reportedly triggered in preemptive attempts to spare ourselves from power line sparks igniting dry forests. Or perhaps we might recall the scenes of floodwaters devouring levees across America, following extreme rainfalls and rising tides, filling not just coastal cities, but low-lying towns many miles from the coast. Then there are the images of flood survivors canoeing or kayaking to and from their homes in New Orleans, through suburban neighborhoods, or possibly stranded on their residential rooftops, with spray-painted pleas for help splayed across bedsheets, calling out to rescue helicopters passing overhead. Or perhaps we picture throngs of protesters hitting the streets, demanding that more be done to address our crisis. Recall the Extinction Rebellion protesters staging massive die-ins and mock funeral processions for the victims of future climate disasters. Maybe we envision climate protest signs appearing closer and closer to home, emblazoned with phrases more prophetic by the day. "Water is the immigrant they should fear," read one sign in New York City, going basically Instagram platinum at the time. On just one day in September of 2019, there were 2,500 protests scheduled in more than 163 countries on all seven continents. Roughly 4 million people stood in a collective call for action to address climate change. Protesters far too young to be worried about the end of the world held signs equally honest and devastating. "There is no planet B," read one. "You'll die of old age. We'll die of climate change," read another. "The climate is changing. Why aren't we?" Youth climate strikes have ballooned out from teen titan Greta Thunberg's humble beginnings outside the Swedish parliament. At the end of 2018, tens of thousands of schoolchildren around Europe followed her lead, skipping school every Friday to protest climate inaction. By the end of 2019, protests had spread with hundreds of thousands marching in New York alone, over 100,000 in London, and nearly 1.5 million across Germany in one day. Streets filled with youth who feel, as Thunberg so perfectly encapsulates, the frustration and sense of despair in watching their world slowly reaching a point of irrevocable damage, without even being of age to cast a vote in stopping it. Or maybe we picture the world's timeless landmarks already damaged by rising tides and swelling rivers. Think of the ancient cathedrals of Venice, partially submerged in November of 2019, with the iconic St. Mark's Basilica closed to tourists when its adjacent plaza's outdoor tables and chairs were bobbing in floodwaters. Or how about the raging Australian bushfires ringing in the new decade, where fire-nados and bloody red skies became the new normal? The combined rise in heat, dryness, and the subsequent wildfires created an environment so hot that so-called pyrocumulonimbus clouds, bringing with them fire-induced thunderstorms, formed as a result, according to CNN weather specialists. Embers carried by strong gusts of wind continually confounded responders with fires forming on multiple fronts, later converging into massive superfires. Local news anchors reported live that they could even taste ashes in the air while filming the locals fleeing to escape boats. The scenes went viral immediately. The charred remains of kangaroos caught up in fences as they fled, and the koalas so parched by the blazing heat, they readily took sips from water bottles held by firefighters and dispatch soldiers. This is how many of us see the effects of climate change, through the lens of scattered headlines, only loosely connected through their sense of doom and foreboding. The only theme connecting these images, aside from the shock and awe of our world under siege, is the sense that nobody really seems to have a stable plan for what we're going to do here. The advancement of climate science, it seems, has simply been a never-ending stream of more and more bad news, punctuated by the occasional not-so-bad news, in the words of atmospheric scientist Catherine Hayhoe. This book was written to highlight that many scientists and organizational leaders out there do, in fact, have viable plans for achieving our climate goals and saving our planet. incredible new advancements in science and technology have been developed that will be game-changing in our fight to stop the rise in global temperatures before it's too late. My goal is to reinforce, in the paraphrased words of Thunberg herself, that we've been failing, but have not yet failed. The problem, widely acknowledged and broadcast, is that we have pumped too many greenhouse gases into the atmosphere. In short, while we can now live lives of unparalleled luxury compared to past generations, we use very dangerous kinds of fuel to make it all happen. The energy we use for feeding, housing, moving, and entertaining ourselves are largely reliant upon fossil fuels like coal, oil, and natural gas, which, when burned to create the energy we need to power nearly anything we do, also release harmful emissions of carbon dioxide, CO2. What makes our problem so monumental in scope is that burning fossil fuels is now so entrenched within every level of societal function that swapping out these fuels will require massive infrastructure change. And that's not mere hyperbole. It includes everything from the clothes we put on in the morning to where our breakfast cereal comes from, the car we drive to our daily job, and the show on Netflix we stream at night. Nearly all of it has run on fossil fuels over the course of many decades. As a result, we've been pumping emissions of CO2 and other greenhouse gases into the atmosphere for quite a while. With an excess of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, our first order of business will be to stop emitting more. After all, when you find yourself in a hole, the first step is to stop digging. Finding ways to feed, house, move, and entertain ourselves without the emissions should be the first thing we do. Moreover, we need to find energy sources that involve no net increase in emissions when either sourced or used. That's a tall order, but incredible new advancements in science and technology are getting us very close. We'll explore them throughout this book. Still, reports are clear that transitioning toward a cleaner and more renewably powered civilization will not be enough to save us. Significant damage has already been done. Even if each of us were to procure our power from sustainable solar panels, drive electric cars, and give up meat for good, the existing greenhouse gases in our atmosphere will continue to warm the planet for many years to come. The latest report from the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, IPCC, as of early 2020, indicates that we will need to address those emissions even as we transition from fossil fuels. So our second order of business, arguably more difficult than our first, will be to remove a large portion of the carbon emissions we've already released. We have developed incredible new methods to accomplish this feat, but the cheapest, most reliable method for removing a greenhouse gas from the atmosphere is clearly not putting it there in the first place. Globally, our emissions have continued to rise annually. At the end of 2019, our carbon emissions hit another record high of nearly 37 billion metric tons, or gigatons, GT. But the rise had at least been slowing. Some of the world's largest emitters, the United States and the European Union, both managed to cut their carbon dioxide output. Global emissions from coal, the worst of all fossil fuels, continued to decline around the world. So, it is certainly possible to be a top industrial power and cut your emissions. Experts believe the continuing rise was potentially due to more output from China specifically, and more developing areas furthering their use of natural gas. Data from the World Economic Forum's Annual Energy Transition Index tells us that Scandinavian countries are leading the world with renewables. Sweden, Switzerland, Norway, Finland, and Denmark took spots 1 through 5, respectively. Iceland was also in the top 10. The UK is also pushing forward. In 2017, carbon emissions actually fell to levels not seen since 1890. Incredible new advancements in renewable energy technology developed by scientists and engineers around the world are driving this process. And even more innovations are on the way to help speed up our transition. According to an analysis from Bloomberg, it is already cheaper for two-thirds of the global population to get power by building a new wind or solar farm than building a fossil fuel power plant. Not just better for the environment, but cheaper. In fact, solar energy is increasing so rapidly that one analyst with the World Economic Forum recently declared that the world will add nearly 70,000 solar panels every hour over the next 5 years. Many of these panels will increasingly feature new, state-of-the-art upgrades in efficiency and performance, forcing us to reconsider what is possible with solar energy. The chapters ahead will focus on how new science and new technology are ushering in a much-needed boost of speed for clean and sustainable energy. Chapter 2 will hit you hard with what we're up against in our changing climate, and a view of how much our world has already changed. It is a sobering assessment, but it's absolutely crucial that we are honest about the size and scope of our problem. Doing so will help to showcase how truly transformative the impending new developments in clean tech really are. Chapter 3 will outline some of the most amazing new renewable energy innovations on the verge of changing the world. For example, did you know that research teams have developed next-gen solar energy tech that will not only power your home long after the sun goes down, but can also produce clean drinking water for your family at the same time? Did you know that by focusing on microscopic aspects of solar cell tech, previously unattainable levels of efficiency have been obtained? Or that thermal panels may be able to provide even more energy coverage than traditional solar panels? Did you know that engineers are crafting smart highways lined with solar strips to not only illuminate our lane lights at night, but also to wirelessly charge electric vehicles as they pass by? Or that electric vehicles we're used to charging at night will soon be two-way generators capable of supplying power to our homes overnight and charging up with renewable energy during the day? Wind energy is improving too. It may sound incredible, but some newer wind turbine models will actually be larger than the Empire State Building. Engineering advancements in turbine blade tech could reduce manufacturing costs up to 90%, leading to similar reductions in cost for builders. Innovative new designs are integrating smaller, maneuverable wind energy drones, capable of self-piloting, with a satellite uplink harnessing the power of aerial swells at higher altitudes, then relaying that energy down to the grid below through a ground tether. In Chapter 4, we'll cover even more advanced renewables that are often less explored in mainstream literature. Some are so groundbreaking that they will impact industries far outside energy production. For example, did you know that biofuels, once derided as overhyped and non-competitive, have now been genetically overhauled after years of bioengineering to become a carbon-neutral, ace-in-the-hole fuel source being developed by big oil? Or that scientists are now exploring a new and emerging field called synthetic biology for ways to design biofuel sources never before seen in nature. Scientists are also developing new applications for an energy source derived from the most abundant element in the known universe, hydrogen. Advanced fuel cell tech and hydrogen refinement have progressed considerably, bringing us newer possibilities to use it more actively. And speaking of new fuel technology, did you know that scientists have now developed the means to produce solar fuel, using rooftop refineries trapping only sunlight and ambient air? We're even developing remarkable new energy techs like smart clothing. So-called green wearables may soon be outfitted with yarn-like zinc-ion threading to churn out electrical power whenever bent, stretched, or even washed with water. Sidewalks have been designed to generate power with the footfall of pedestrian traffic, and scientists are now trying to utilize the immense amounts of waste heat being released by our electronics and appliances. Want a new taste of the sci-fi? Try the incredible use of artificial intelligence to align vast fields of mirrors, perfectly in tune with the sun as it moves across the sky, to concentrate energy on a single point. generating heat in excess of 1,000 degrees Celsius for energy and industry alike. Chapter 5 is about the non-stop forms of energy we will use to support grid function on our way to zero emissions. Critics of renewable energy often cite the unreliable intermittency of sun and wind as the Achilles heel of using these energy sources. What they do not often discuss, however, are the new advancements in not just energy storage and grid functions to smooth out the peaks and valleys of our energy use, but also the new advancements in essentially never-ending energy supplies of hydro, tidal, and wave technology. And let's not forget the new engineering initiatives to tap the world's ever-present geothermal reserves and our budding new capabilities in nuclear power to augment the mix. The energy game is changing. A next-generation combination of smart grids, microgrids, and 5G connectivity between devices will forever alter the way we use energy. Chapter 6 covers how we will still manage some semblance of life as usual without our historically heavy carbon footprint. While we do require some systemic changes to our way of life, they need not mean giving up some of the things we love the most. New advancements in materials sciences and biotechnology offer us the chance to replace some of the most energy-intensive, carbon-heavy industrial systems we use with greener alternatives. Did you know, for example, that bioengineers can now brew clothing threads in labs, or that algae can produce bioplastic entirely without the toxic infrastructure we normally use, or that we now have microbes capable of building things? Chapter 7 explores feeding the post-carbon world. Our ever-growing global population is often considered another Achilles heel of climate action plans, but advanced, new agricultural technology, so-called ag tech, offers us several compelling new opportunities to feed our populations cleanly and sustainably. Did you know that bioengineers have fortified not only our soils, but the crops growing in them? Crops will soon be more drought-resistant, heat-resistant, and pest-resistant without harsh chemicals. State-of-the-art soil-free aeroponic farms can also utilize AI to supply just the right amount of water and nutrients needed to grow crops indoors and therefore pesticide-free, without herbicides or excess nitrogen. Chapter 8 will explore some of the most compelling adaptations we've created for making our homes smart and our cities even smarter. For example, we now have access to windows that not only block specific wavelengths of light and turn into shades at the direction of an app, but can also generate energy at the same time. We can block out more solar heat while still letting in visible light to save on wasteful AC, and indoor solar cell tech can actually tap the power of ambient light. Research teams from all around the world are hard at work figuring out how we can cool the planet even while continuing to fuel our cars, heat our homes, and feed billions of people. However, as noted, carbon neutrality alone will not be enough to save us. The world will keep warming unless we actively remove greenhouse gases in the near future. Chapter 9 will focus on our newfound abilities to do so. Since the Industrial Revolution, our average global temperature has increased about 1 degree Celsius. 1.8 degrees Fahrenheit. Scientists estimate that if we want to hold the rise in global temperature steady at 1.5 degrees Celsius, 2.7 degrees Fahrenheit, above our pre-industrial levels, we need to begin our return of atmospheric levels of carbon dioxide to about 350 parts per million, ppm. For scope, in May of 2019, we officially reached 415 ppm CO2 in the atmosphere. Who knows what milestone we will have passed by the time you hear this? Given that we have already done so much damage by not transitioning away from fossil fuels quickly enough, scientists at the IPCC estimate that we will inevitably need to rely on so-called negative emission technologies. These are largely technological options, high-tech and low-tech, to help us remove CO2 from the atmosphere going forward. Some are as simple as planting more trees to absorb more CO2. Others are high-tech, like renewably powered carbon capture machines and bioengineered, supercharged plants designed to absorb more CO2. The former option may even be bolstered by new advancements in our ability to upcycle captured CO2 into high-value commodities and fuels, creating new and evolving market forces to incentivize the capture of carbon naturally. The goal is to reach a point in which advanced renewables can power our civilizations cleanly and sustainably, while we selectively draw down greenhouse gases from the atmosphere. That is what will solve the climate crisis. At that point, called drawdown, we will essentially turn back the clock to a time before we blanketed ourselves in excess carbon emissions. This is why the international nonprofit Project Drawdown exists, to collect, analyze, and disseminate information on how we will actually solve the climate crisis. Sadly, the very reason we are developing many of these technologies is because significant damage has already been done. We already have climate refugees. Floods have already destroyed homes. Species are already going extinct at record rates around the globe. Vulnerable communities have already been deeply impacted by heat waves and droughts and extreme weather. Chapter 10 is dedicated to the damage control we will need to engage in as we progress toward carbon neutrality and as we draw down CO2 thereafter. It is important to note that science and business typically work in tandem. If a particular scientist or a whole lab spearheads something incredible, they will often commercialize and subsequently market the idea to make some money. As such, we'll be exploring labs and new companies fairly evenly throughout this book. I mention these two entities because I'm not affiliated with, or invested in, any of the companies discussed. They are often merely companies started by scientists, capitalizing on new technology. Many of the technologies we will cover throughout this book once existed purely in the realm of science fiction. A scientist would not have believed even 15 years ago that we are now turning landfill waste into jet fuel, or that we might potentially have renewably powered and AI-managed indoor vertical farms, saving up to 95% of the water used in traditional agriculture. Scientists of 10 years ago would not believe that by 2020, we would be mass-producing the process of turning microbes into tiny self-sustaining factories, capable of building and assembling everything from fuel to food to the fabric threads we weave into clothing. For these reasons and more, rumors of our demise have been greatly exaggerated. This is not to dispel the need for urgent, systemic action in decarbonizing our energy and our industry, but to spread the narrative that we finally have hope, not anchored by wishful thinking or promissory science. Rather, we now have hope grounded in the increasingly realistic prospect that we truly can save ourselves from the climate crisis and craft a much more livable world for greater portions of the human population than we ever have before. Chapter 2. Let's face it, our planet is changing. Climate believers, climate deniers, deep in our hearts, we think it will happen somewhere else, in some other place. We don't actually say this, but we may think it. In a poorer one, say Puerto Rico or New Orleans or Cape Town, or one of those islands where the sea level is rising. Or it will happen in some other time, in 2025 or 2040 or next year. But we are here to tell you, in this postcard from the former paradise, that it won't happen next year or somewhere else. It will happen right where you live, and it could happen today. No one will be spared. Nora Gallagher, Paradise Wildfire Survivor. You can save time debating climate change deniers by simply discussing the facts we have empirically measured on record. You don't even need to use the phrase climate change or climate crisis. Because if we're just going by the facts of what we measure in the environment, Some things are damn near indisputable. Regardless of your thoughts on the more extreme scenarios many scientists have postulated, 2019 was officially the second hottest year since we started recording temperatures systematically. And that's a fact. As noted in Chapter 1, historical data tells us the Earth has warmed about 1 degree Celsius, 1.8 degrees Fahrenheit, since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution. But the process seems to be speeding up, as the majority of this increase has occurred throughout the past few decades. The UN's World Meteorological Organization, WMO, tells us that the last decade was almost certainly the hottest decade on record. The National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, NOAA, helped confirm that, telling us that 8 of the 10 warmest years on record occurred between 2010 and 2020. The single hottest year ever recorded was 2016. Regardless of what one thinks about climate change, these are simply facts. Within 2019 alone, June was the hottest June ever recorded. July was the hottest month ever. September was the hottest September on record. October was the hottest October on record. November was the second hottest November on record. In December, when the month tied for the hottest December on record, a man in Australia was able to cook a whole roast pork in his car. In June 2019, schools across Europe were closed due to the record-breaking heat in Germany, Poland, and the Czech Republic. The hottest temperature ever recorded in France reached 45.9 degrees Celsius, 115 degrees Fahrenheit. Heat waves caused such widespread wildfires that soldiers in countries around the world were dispatched to fight them. City fountains normally reserved for artistic appreciation were full of bathers soaking up water to escape the heat. Despite the record high temperatures, though, Europeans were comparatively luckier than folks in parts of the world closer to global hotspots. Some regions in Pakistan, for example, regularly topped 50 degrees Celsius, 122 degrees Fahrenheit, for months at a time over the summer. Reports tell us these trends have also continued into 2020. January 2020 was officially the warmest January on record globally, inching just past January of 2016 by 0.03 degrees. February was then the second hottest February on record. One could fill an entire book with stories of humans adapting to and suffering through our new excessive heat. Social media shares of meat being cooked in cars. Olympic athletes training for 5K races after the 10K was deemed too dangerous due to chance of heat stroke. Companies around the world suddenly providing air conditioning outside as workers huddled around fans on break, etc., were all too numerous. There were simply too many dire excessive heat situations to cover here. What may matter more, however, are the ways in which heat will impact us going forward. Nighttime heat has actually risen twice as fast as the rate of heat increase during daytimes, for example. Two journalists from the New York Times were dispatched to Phoenix to cover the expanded new nightlife of people adapting to those more tolerable moments outside. Outdoor workers were often beginning their duties at dawn and dusk, while hikers and runners moved toward pre-dawn workouts. The city of Phoenix was, as they had heard, turning into a city of vampires. Low overnight temperatures have increased roughly 1.4 degrees Fahrenheit since the year 1895, whereas the daytime increase has only been about 0.7 degrees. A side note on how rising temperatures will impact workers going forward. NOAA has estimated that increased heat and humidity have already reduced the amount of work people can do outdoors by 10% globally. They expect the figure could double by 2050, which is particularly bad news for landscape and construction workers, among others. Worse yet, even as temperatures continue to climb, urbanization is continually rising around the world. Combine the two together, and we may have a potentially deadly compounding of the urban heat island effect, UHI, forecasted to increase in the future. As global average temperatures rise and regional temperatures rise, the experienced temperatures within urban areas will feel at least a few degrees hotter. One new study from the Yale School of Forestry and Environmental Studies, F&ES, for example, revealed that the average temperature rise in urban areas will increase from about 0.5 degrees Celsius to as many as 3 extra degrees in some areas. That is bad news for the estimated 60 to 70% of the entire world's population, who will reportedly be living in urban areas by mid-century. Now, we can't attribute every heat wave we experience to climate change, but a long and increasingly well-established consensus among scientists is that rising global temperatures will make heat waves more frequent, more drawn out, and more intense. In just a short time, we can expect more locations to experience heat waves. France, for example, experiences double the heat waves now as they did 34 years ago, and this number is projected to double again by 2050. Predictably, widespread increases in regional temperatures will also drive up the use of air conditioning, leading to an increase in electricity demand and the harmful chemicals present in refrigerants. It will potentially create a deadly and mutual reinforcement loop. Greater production and use of air conditioners will involve more burning of fossil fuels, which will only make the temperature rise even worse. One study recently predicted that electricity for cooling demand will increase from roughly 400 terawatt hours per year, TWH per year, to nearly 1,400 TWH per year by the end of the century. That even accounts for air conditioner technology becoming more efficient over time. Sure, for the investors out there, it will turn a roughly $50 billion per year industry into a $1.5 trillion one. But how does that translate into increased emissions? Research conducted by the Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory and the International Energy Agency, IEA, estimated that typical AC units will come to account for over 130 gross tons of CO2 emissions between now and 2050. That will be roughly 20 to 40% of our remaining carbon budget allowed under the Paris Agreement if we want to stay below 2 degrees Celsius. In a country like India, which will face soaring temperatures in the middle of this century and extend into the second half of it, currently fewer than 10% of households have AC. As the Indian middle class expands and wealth increases, that number is expected to rise dramatically. The IEA has further predicted an impending phenomenon they call the cold crunch in their Future of Cooling report. According to their estimates, air conditioners and electric fans already account for nearly 20% of the total electricity used in buildings around the world today. But this amount is expected to rise dramatically as emerging economies supply more buildings and residences with AC. With temperatures rising and air conditioning use predicted to skyrocket, one recent study further declared that areas encompassing up to a fifth of the world's population will exceed heat waves surpassing the upper limits of human survivability. This will occur by the end of this century without immediate action to address climate change. As temperatures rise, soil moisture can evaporate and ambient air can become more arid, drying out plants. Dry vegetation, coupled with high temperatures, can make for easily ignitable materials essentially anywhere the combination is happening. While we can't blame every new wildfire on climate change, we certainly have much to say about the increased likelihood, intensity, and duration of wildfires going forward. Or, as environmental writer Bill McKibben succinctly phrased it, prolonged drought, then a record heat wave, then a spark. Warmer nights will also contribute to more sustained fire spread. Throughout 2019 and into 2020, wildfires raged in California, Canada, Australia, Alaska, Siberia, and other areas. The Australian bushfires, made worse by the Indian Ocean dipole, a phenomenon similar to El Niño, and the hot, dry spell it can embolden, burned up enough vegetation to create a carbon pulse of lost CO2 into the atmosphere. Researchers at NASA reported to The Guardian that the spike was roughly half of the country's total annual emissions alone. You might recall that the Amazon's wildfires became an international crisis when about 3 football fields worth of Amazonian trees burned up every minute throughout July 2019 alone. Fires burned so pervasively that black smoke billowed nearly 1,000 miles away to blot out sunlight in Sao Paulo on August 19. Of course, several of the Amazon's worst fires were intentionally set to clear land for grazing and cash crop plantations, but the speed and intensity of flames were undoubtedly worsened by hot, dry vegetation around more densely forested areas. Satellite imagery also later confirmed the link between hotter and drier temperatures with increased fires. "Our house is burning," declared French President Emmanuel Macron, echoing one of Greta Thunberg's signature phrases. The Californian wildfires raged for so long that fire seasons will likely turn into fire years, according to the Wildland Fire Leadership Council. Survivors from the Santa Rosa fire recounted the horror of heat so intense that aluminum wheels on their cars had melted and dripped down driveways like rivers of mercury. In the case of Alaskan wildfires, roughly 2.5 million acres of tundra and snow forest were lost. The fires were visible from space. On CNN, one could view vast swaths of smoke blanketing Alaska, Greenland, and Siberia. In Siberia, the amount of land lost to fires topped 6 million acres over the summer of 2019, roughly the size of Vermont. Atmospheric scientist Santiago Gasso declared via Twitter that a smoke lid from the fire had spread over about 4.5 million square kilometers across central northern Asia. Fires in our planet's northern regions are troubling for a number of reasons. For one, the fires indicate that more northern areas are becoming as susceptible as others to easy ignition conditions. Thomas Smith, an assistant professor in environmental geography at the London School of Economics, reported to USA Today that the fires were igniting far enough north to tap into peat soils, creating a far worse condition for fire responders and for the planet in general. Peat soil holds immense amounts of carbon, and it also allows fires to burn underground, popping up in areas responders may not be. We find ourselves living in a world where wildfires are destined to happen more frequently, spread more quickly, burn hotter, longer, and emanate from more unanticipated sources. Yes, hotter and drier vegetation will ignite more quickly, but in California, the deadly ranch and car fires were caused by random sparks from things like concrete construction and from a car tire rim scraping against asphalt, respectively. How are you possibly going to plan for that? With more of the Arctic on fire than ever before, Arctic ice is melting far faster than scientists had anticipated. So fast, in fact, that the Canadian Arctic is reportedly melting roughly 70 years ahead of schedule. Sustained ice mass lost in Greenland throughout 2019 was so bad it reached levels not expected until the year 2070. This is particularly bad news, given that the Greenland ice sheets is so large that if it were to melt entirely, sea levels would rise by an incredible 23 feet. And it's no safer at the South Pole either. New research tells us the melting rate has literally doubled over the past 6 years. It appears that oceanographers and glaciologists have only stories of faster-than-predicted melting to tell. Alaskan glaciers are melting potentially up to 100 times faster than previously thought. Himalayan glaciers are melting twice as fast as they were in the year 2000. This means that the world's glaciers have lost more than 25% of their ice between the years 2000 and 2016. A melting Arctic, of course, also thaws the ground below, which is really bad news. A non-trivial number of scientists are now telling us that we're particularly doomed due to the melting of the permafrost there. In October 2019, Russian scientists retrieving data on an Arctic expedition discovered, for the first time, that methane was present and boiling on the surface of shoreline waters, visible to the naked eye. Normally, large amounts of methane, roughly 84 times more potent a greenhouse gas than CO2 in the first two decades after its release, are safely trapped in regional permafrost. Scientists have often calculated the effects of methane emissions globally from its main anthropogenic sources, livestock and fertilizer runoff. The methane trapped in permafrost was thought to likely remain there, hence the name permafrost. But increases in global temperatures have begun thawing the suddenly not-so-permafrost. One UN report called this warming the waking of a sleeping giant, and warned that what happens in the Arctic does not stay in the Arctic. Even more alarmingly, dozens of researchers from around the world are also studying underground temperatures. They have found that areas even tens of feet below the ground have increased in all permafrost zones on Earth. Methane is therefore now leaking from thawing soils and seabeds. As more methane is released, more warming will occur, speeding up the process of more methane release. Scientists fear a positive feedback loop could occur in runaway methane increase. Fortunately, new research from the University of Rochester, published during the time this book was in editing stages, revealed that melting permafrost in the Arctic is less likely to release apocalyptic amounts of methane into the atmosphere than previously believed. While that does not entirely absolve us from one of the worst doomsday scenarios, it does provide us with some small respite. Alarmingly, though, Russian scientists have already reported that the rate of underwater permafrost melting has doubled over the past 30 years. In fact, in some areas of the Russian Arctic, released methane has reached 9 times the atmospheric average. This rightfully still scares scientists. A few years ago, the sentiment was captured succinctly by Danish climatologist Jason Box, who opined on Twitter, "If even a small fraction of Arctic seafloor carbon is released to the atmosphere, we're effed." As our permafrost becomes less permanent and ice continues to melt faster than expected, all of this contributes to the sea level rise we will see throughout this century. According to a devastating study released in 2019, previous estimations of sea level rise have actually been too modest. New research tells us that some 150 million people are currently living on land expected to be below high tide by mid-century. For scale, research indicates that by the year 2050, if we do not address climate change and at least slow the rise in temperature, southern Vietnam could essentially disappear underwater. That means the 20 million people who live on this land, including much of the capital in Ho Chi Minh City, will be displaced. Shanghai's core streets will be submerged. An incredible 10% of citizens in Thailand reside on land projected to be submerged in such a scenario. Large swaths of Mumbai, India, would all be underwater. Alexandria, Egypt, with us since about 330 BCE, will be lost to the tides. Unsurprisingly, scientists also tell us the heat absorbed by our oceans has reached record levels. Even as we feel an increase in surface level temperatures here, the ocean actually absorbs much of the planet's increase in heat. By some estimates, the ocean has retained over 90% of the excess heat being generated on our planet since the year 1955, giving some scientists the impression that 90% of our climate change story is being ignored. Just as we experience heat waves on land, heat waves can occur underwater, and, as it turns out, aquatic heat waves now threaten the well-being of corals, fish, plankton, and other marine life, and, you guessed it, more frequently than previously thought. Researchers believe that warming oceans have caused mass migrations of fish toward the poles. One study published in Science found that warming oceans have impacted sustainable catches significantly, leading to an average decline of about 4.1%. Scientists studying coral health have noted that oceanic heat waves have increased in frequency, duration, and intensity. In fact, underwater heat waves have been so intense that some colonies of coral around the Great Barrier Reef have simply died instantly. But for other colonies, sustained temperature heights otherwise result in coral degradation and bleaching. As sea levels continue to rise and a warmer atmosphere increasingly holds, and subsequently releases, more water, worse floods are expected to increase. In fact, so-called 100-year floods that are supposed to occur only once every century, or that have a 1% chance of happening every year, are now predicted to occur every 30 years along the Southeast Atlantic and Gulf of Mexico shorelines, or perhaps annually in places like New England. An estimated 40 million people in the United States, for example, already live in areas with a 25% chance of their home being flooded before they can pay off a 30-year mortgage. Many local governments now view these floods as inevitable, and rather than bailing out residents who insist on not moving and rebuilding after every flood, are simply buying out homes and telling people to move. The flood and rebuild status quo has increasingly faltered and been abandoned. Continual costs of rebuilding and flood prevention, like sandbagging, setting up community shelters, and cleaning up scattered flood debris, become less of a financial shackle. Worse yet, are less obvious risks to human life from increasing floodwaters. As they encroach upon chemical storage sites, or the synthetic fertilizers embedded in farm soils, or the suite of deadly chemicals we often have under our own sinks, this all washes outward together into a toxic soup of random materials. This effect is similar to what happens when wildfires manage to snare, say, chemical processing facilities, or the asbestos in old homes. The resulting airborne ash then contains thousands of foreign chemicals suddenly in breathable space for many miles. And there's a flip side to the extreme rainfall caused by a warmer atmosphere: drought-stricken farmlands suffering from lost soil moisture, and local aquifers drying up during periods of extreme heat. Water shortages are reportedly impending over the coming years as temperatures climb. One new study revealed that the world will experience more frequent and extreme droughts and aridity over the coming century. Even a country like the UK, world famous for its rain, is predicted to face significant water deficits by 2050. Moreover, the melting glaciers will lead to less water gleaned from glacier springs. This is a problem for the literal billions of world citizens who rely on these springs. One study published in Nature declared that 20% of the world's population, roughly 1.9 billion people, may be at risk from a loss thereof. It's especially troubling because the demand for water will likely rise in hotter years ahead. Approximately 78 natural water towers, in which mountain stream systems generate and store water in glaciers, are at risk. The Indus Water Tower, for example, fed by the Hindu Kush and Himalayan mountains, sustains people in China, India, Pakistan, and Afghanistan. All will be at risk of reduced water supplies. When towns and cities see their reservoirs run dry, the results are not pleasant. City fountains shut off for water conservation. Showers only happen every few days. Lineups at rationing stations become hotbeds of heightened frustrations. One might also consider the increasing acidification of our world's oceans. As we pump CO2 into the air, a large amount of it is absorbed into the oceans, driving up the pH balance. Carbon dioxide absorbed at the surface level reacts with water to form carbonic acid, which oceans then disperse throughout bodies of water. Incredibly, scientists have found that marine ecosystems have undergone an average increase of acidity around 30% over the last 200 years. One study from NOAA scientists and other academic partners found that some coastal waters, off the California coast particularly, are acidifying twice as fast as the global average. Changes like these could stand to dramatically alter local marine ecosystems and seafood industries. When waters acidify, this initiates a cascading effect in which the calcium carbonate making up mussel shells and coral skeletons can then weaken. Increasingly, acidified waters also mute low-frequency sounds, causing harm to marine species dependent upon acoustic signals to communicate and survive. Evolutionary biology has been remarkably adaptive in changing environments, but sometimes environments change so quickly that not even advantageous mutations can catch up. This results in a loss of life when pre-existing organisms suddenly cannot cope with new environmental pressures. We then see a stark loss of biodiversity, wiping out particularly susceptible organisms and putting anything relying on them at risk. According to a United Nations report on biodiversity loss, more than 1 million species of plants and animals are now at risk of extinction worldwide. Climate change, created by the burning of fossil fuels, according to the report, has simply made it too hot, wet, or dry for some species to survive. Sadly, nearly half of the world's land mammals and nearly a quarter of birds have already had their habitats damaged significantly by climate change. Scientists at the University of Arizona have further calculated that as many as one-third of plant and animal species could be gone in 50 years' time. Animals crucial for vast food chains are also increasingly at risk. Insects, for example, sustain larger animals, pollinate plants, and help to keep plants healthy in other ways. But new research reveals that we are on pace to wipe out 40% of insect species in mere decades through a combination of climate change and agrochemical pollutants. You'd expect that with data points like these, world governments would be hard at work solving these problems. And yet, some of the world's largest governments are stalling or denying outright that anthropogenic climate change is real. Political inaction has been due, in part, to dedicated misinformation campaigns undertaken by fossil fuel energy giants. We now understand that they paid large sums of money to hire fringe, black hat scientists and internet forum board trolls to disagree with an otherwise robust scientific consensus on climate change. For this, companies like ExxonMobil and BP are currently being sued for technically lying to investors about the dangers of climate change. Cases are still ongoing as I write this. These days, fortunately, while we all know that scientific views can be mixed regarding the scale and scope of climate change, few debate with the 97% of scientists who agree the change is being driven by human activity. In fact, anthropogenic causes for climate change through the use of fossil fuels has now reached the gold standard level of academic certainty, as ordained by the Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory in California. The United States under Donald Trump is perhaps the example of political inaction regarding climate change. It wasn't enough that President Trump had once declared climate change a Chinese hoax intended to stunt American industry as a private citizen. Trump effectively drew climate denialism from internet forum boards and thrust it upon the country's institutional base. Pulling out of the Paris-called Paris Agreement was one such move. The 90 and counting environmental rules and regulations rolled back at this time of writing, another, such as the Obama-era regulation on fuel economy, poised to keep 6 billion tons of CO2 from the atmosphere. On the other hand, the numbers show that Paris was already a bastion of global inaction. Between the signing of the accord and December 2019's climate conference in Madrid, where actionable plans were to be presented, greenhouse gas emissions had still risen by 4%. That is a slowdown of how much they could have risen, but gases were still rising. Madrid, of course, was another failure. Approximately zero tangible outcomes were produced or committed to, despite 500,000 protesters marching in the streets outside. Sadly, the drive to force politicians into action can stutter and misstep amidst all the positive reinforcement of climate protests. The data shows that there are large portions of us who unfortunately let the hopelessness of a colossal environmental challenge get the best of us, while another large portion allows the anomalies of extreme weather to become normalized. It's just the way things are, we think. Eco-anxiety, for example, has been a diagnosable illness from the American Psychological Association since 2017. The diagnosis captures the prolonged dread imposed by a seemingly inevitable loss involving the world's many great species and landmarks for future generations. psychologists believe the diagnosis would be more widespread were it more reported. It should be no surprise, then, that with climate change affecting so many aspects of citizens' everyday lives, it has been called a threat multiplier by scientists monitoring dangers from all sides around the world. And not just because climate change could impact the infrastructure of coastal cities, crop yields feeding populations, and more, but rather because of how interconnected and globalized the world now is. A grain shortage halfway across the world could affect everything from bread prices to beer shortages elsewhere. American military commanders, for example, view climate change as a potentially catastrophic security threat, despite what the Trump administration might say about the situation. Converging environmental threats can all contribute toward destabilizing communities in ways that can invite military involvement. Rising temperatures, subsequent heat waves, and sustained droughts can lead to water shortages and health crises. Increasing superstorms can lead to fracturing of coastal communities. Any of these effects, or a combination thereof, can lead to civil unrest. Less functional nations face the additional danger of turning into failed states under the stress of environmental damages. Add to that the impact of mass migrations from an area especially beset by climate chaos. All of these could increase the likelihood of a country like America being dragged into ugly foreign wars. International threat expert Michael Clare writes in his latest book, All Hell Breaking Loose, The Pentagon's Perspective on Climate Change, that even collateral effects of climate change may drag the world's elite armies into confrontation. These effects could include arguments over natural resources in a newly melted and accessible Arctic, crucial water resources crossing borders like the Himalayan glaciers, shortchanging China or India, and more. In fact, according to one study from Stanford, the influence of climate on warfare will increase the statistical likelihood of armed conflict by an estimated 5 times. Over the past several years, to cite just one example, Chinese cargo ship crews have routinely traveled nearly 3,000 miles from home to Russia's northern coast through a newly opened passage officials have dubbed the Polar Silk Road, which countries may fight over in a warming world. There could also be civil conflicts at home from displacements due to flooding, lack of resources following superstorm recoveries, and more. Research also indicates that coastal flooding due to either extreme weather or rising seas will lead to mass migrations inland to the U.S. As another recent study from the University of Colorado Boulder predicted, the United States could see tens of thousands of extra violent crimes every year due to climate impacts alone. Even now, Oxfam has estimated in one of its Forced From Home briefings that one person is forced out of their home every 2 seconds due to climate-fueled disasters. And if these evictions force the wealthy to flee elsewhere, UN experts fear we may experience a climate apartheid in which the rest of us are forced to simply linger and suffer during the aftermath of environmental damages. As I said, one could write an entire book wholly dedicated to the world headlines describing record-breaking heat waves, the ongoing collapse of species worldwide, the floods wiping out world monuments and landmarks, the rainfall accumulating toxins from unanticipated chemical soups, the droughts parching crucial farmland that feeds the world's population, and all the potential global instability in our lifetimes due to climate change. Indeed, those books already exist. What kind of future?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.